most important aspect of underlying illness. If you make a diagnosis early, the outcome of a child will be better. That's why many a times we'll be able to make a diagnosis faster because we see more number of cases with fever and rash than the dermatologist. But at times we need some challenging rashes where we need to make a diagnosis a bit difficult. At that time, we need to have a help of dermatologist. So going on to this one, I really thank the module preparator, Dr. Abhishek Day, who is the pediatric dermatologist from Kolkata. He did a wonderful job of presenting this module to our IAP Dharma schedule. As we all know that a febrile child with rash always create a diagnostic challenge for pediatricians. As we know that these fever and rash have many causes. If you see the table, it will be big enough to, and it may take a day to analyze each of these causes. But broadly, it has been divided into two types. Maybe it is because of infective, which we see commonly in younger children. And the another group is non-infective variety. Maybe in the older age group, these are the common causes for the fever with the rash. Now, what is more important for us to make early diagnosis whenever a child comes with fever and rash is a proper approach. That is with meticulous and methodical history taking. Added to this one, a proper physical examination and minimal laboratory support if you require, then we'll be able to make a possible diagnosis and we can install the appropriate treatment at the earliest. Now, as we are seeing these cases with fever, rash is typically we need to analyze what is the distinct morphological way it is presenting, where it starts, where it spreads. That will give us the proper clue for early diagnosis of the illness. Now, as I said, there are many causes. Broadly, we divided into infective and non-infective. And these are the infective causes. Mainly, it is viral infections like measles, rubella, varicella, and so. And added to this one, now the pandemic has also added because still COVID-19, though we are seeing less number in pediatrics, but still we are seeing these cases and they are presenting with the rash, which again, we are already having existing problem of fever and rash with so many causes. And this one is added one nowadays. And then the bacterial causes like staph and streptococcus, which are also a common causes leading to fever and rash. And more importantly now in certain parts of India, not all, but definitely now it is an upcoming disease that is about rickettsial disease. Oppose, we are seeing even in southern India, middle part of the India, and more so in the northern part of the India. But overall, now that is again an upcoming disease with the fever and rash. Coming to the non-infective causes is basically the collagen vascular diseases and to some extent drug reactions will present with fever and rash. So what I will do is I will cover up some of the important lesions that are very important in the diagnosis. That is by the meaning is the moment we see the rash, we'll be able to make a diagnosis. So those rashes and some of the challenging rashes I'm going to talk or discuss in the next 10 or 15 minutes or so. So these are some of the, I start with very common, which we all aware of this one, the measles rash. Usually it is associated with fever and prodromal symptoms, but the typical way of diagnosis is by the appearance of the rash. Usually it is erythematous macropapular rash and it begins just behind the ears and then progresses towards the downward in the subchordal direction. But what is more important is whenever you see this history, you need to open the mouth and see for the typical gray-white sand-like lesions with the surrounding the buccal mucosa opposite to lower second molar tooth. So that is typically called it as coplic spot, which is a pathognomonic of this measles rash. The more important point of this one is the rash resolves on the same order with the residual brownish discoloration and desquamation. And important thing is it will take at least 7 to 10 days to disappear because this is very important. We have other rashes, other viral illness, which can also come similar way, but they fade earliest. Like This is the picture where graphically representing how we can make a rash and other features of measles. So what I wanted to tell here, stress the point is, whenever you get a fever and rash, most importantly, you need to ask at the appearance of rash, what happened to fever? Now, if fever rises at the onset of rash, it indicates probably what we are dealing is measles. If fever decreases at the onset of rash, then it indicates that it may be due to other causes like herpes virus. So this is the point where we need to make a diagnosis, because we can make a diagnosis based on history itself if it has been a proper one. That's how we will make a diagnosis of measles. The rubella is unlike rubiola, what I have described earlier. The rash appears within 24 hours of onset of prodromal symptoms. And more importantly, it starts from the trunk and spreads to the extremities. And more important so is the rash disappears by third day. So unlike measles where it takes 7 to 10 days, here within 3 days, it will disappear. And apart from that, we have other clues for diagnosis of rubella in the form of cervical or post-auricular lymphadenopathy. This is another condition very commonly we come across, that is chickenpox. The typical rash is being described in the textbook as dew drops on rose petal appearance. So usually it occurs after, say, second day of fever and involves mainly trunk and the proximal end of the extremities. So more important feature of this one is it is polymorphic nature. That means some lesions are healing, some are appearing. So all forms of lesions we can see at given period of time. The other typical feature is usually after the appearance of rash, fever will subside within 2 to 4 days, and then rash will start disappearing after 3 to 7 days by leaving hypo or hyperpigmented macules. So this is a way we are making a diagnosis. The very other common pediatric disease, infectious disease, what we come across is infectious mononucleosis. It's again very challenging in the sense that most of the skin rashes are like other viral illnesses, maculopapular. But what is more important is we can get a diagnostic importance by taking a history that if these rashes have increased following intake of certain drugs, especially amoxicillin, it indicates that what we are dealing is infectious mononucleosis. Apart from the fever and rash, we have other clinical features in the form of pharyngeal inflammation, lymphadenopathy, and organomegaly, specifically hepatosplenomegaly. We can make a diagnosis by looking at even the peripheral smear, typical features like downy cells in the peripheral red cells, and the proper diagnosis is by looking at the monospot test. That is a latex agglutination test, which uses the equine RBC for diagnosis. So this is how we make a diagnosis of infectious mononucleosis. The other disease which we come across nowadays all over India, especially southern states and specifically dengue, you are all now well versed that dengue rash can come in all three phases, like in the prodromal phase, in the critical phase, in the defervescence phase. In the prodromal phase, usually it occurs during the febrile phase within 48 hours of fever with a transient generalized macular rash. We can say it is like a flushing. Whereas in critical phase, which is like all the warning signs are there, during that time, there will be a generalized morbilliform maculopapular rash we can see. In the defervescence, we typically see that we have a maculopapular rash, but what is more important is it is usually associated with the itching. And to some extent, we can say that itching with the rash during the defervescence indicates there is a good prognosis. That's what we are, and that's how we are making a diagnosis of dengue rash. So these are some of the pictures of dengue with subconjunctival hemorrhage, flushing in these slides. As with the dengue, we have other arboviral, which also presents with fever and rash, that is chikungunya. But what is more important here is, again, very few viral rashes present with itchy skin lesion, and one is chikungunya. If you find an itchy skin lesion, which appears, say, after 4 to 5 days after fever with arthritis, probably we can make a diagnosis in our setup that it probably what we are dealing is chikungunya infection. So what is more important for us here is it is the diagnosis is basically by clinical rather than the laboratory, because as we are getting a problem in isolating the virus, and whatever the antibody tests are not so good in identifying at the earliest. So we need to stress on this fever, arthritis is more in the older children or adults, whereas arthralgia is very common. And along with that, if you have this maculopapular rash, we can think in terms of chikungunya. So these are some of the pictures showing the chikungunya rash in young children. Like a chickenpox, we have other vesicular lesions very commonly seen in pediatrics, especially very in a high febrile status, like vesicles specifically over the lips, nose, and chin, and probably it is due to herpes simplex. Unlike the chickenpox, which is a polymorphous nature, here it is either it is in the single or in the group and attended to only in a particular area, by which we will be make a diagnosis of herpes simplex virus. The other very classical disease we can make by looking at the rash is erythema infectiosa, which is a typical rash like a slap cheek appearance, what is being described in our textbook. And we are seeing these cases often in some immunocompromised children. And because of the cause for this erythema infectiosum is human parvovirus B19, which is very common in immunocompromised children. It can be seen even in immunocompetent children and very commonly in the age group of children. Remember, the age of the children and the rash appearance is also important in making the diagnosis. Usually we get viral infection in the younger children by below 5 years in specifically, but the other fever with rash like collagen and other drug reaction, generally we get in the older children. This is another very chronic disease which can make parents to be very anxiety, but it is a very benign condition, that is Giannotti-Crosti syndrome. It is also popularly known as papular acrodermatitis. This occurs very commonly in the children between 1 to 6 years of age. The rashes are very typical in the form symmetric, homogeneous, flat-topped pink-brown macules distributed classically across extents are extremities and buttocks. Sometimes we have hemorrhagic or moisturous eczematous papules, but what is more important is it is usually takes longer time to decide. Though it is a benign condition, it takes months together, generally up to 3 months, but on an average, it will last at least 15 to 20 days. What is more important is we need to convince the parents that it is a benign condition, it will take on its own. The common causes, again, lot number of viruses have been enumerated, but very common are Epstein-Barr and cytomegalovirus. So this is, as I said, it is a benign, but makes parents more anxiety, but we need to keep our mind open, saying this is definitely going to disappear on its own. Like other viral, we have another epidemic, what we are seeing in some parts of our country, that is hand-foot-mouth disease. Typically, again, it is a vesical lesions commonly seen over the hands, foot, and mouth. So it starts with high-grade fever and then followed by rashes. So these are typically caused by Coxsackie, and secondly, it may be due to enterovirus infection. So generally, it is again a benign condition, but sometimes it can produce complication in the form of respiratory, like a severe pneumonia, and they can go for ARDS. And sometimes second commonly is neurological infection. They can present with encephalitis. But by and large, it is a benign condition. Again, it will be by disappearing by 3 to 5 days. The other bacterial infection, whatever I have described was earlier typical viral lesions. Now I am describing one or two about the bacterial infection. So one which we come across is scarlet fever. It is rash is typically diffuse, erythematous, very blanchable one. So rash fades with the descamation after 3 to 4 days onset of the fever. So it is commonly due to streptococcal infection, but what is more striking for making a diagnosis of scarlet fever is strawberry tongue. And if you examine the hands also, sometimes you see this Thompson sign, that is pink or red lines formed in the skin creases. That's the sign which is typical of this scarlet fever. So again, a pictorial diagram of diagnosis typically is a strawberry tongue. Now coming to this upcoming disease, what we can say across India, and most of us probably we are seeing these cases in our practice. Only thing, we need to keep our high index of suspicion, then only we'll be making the early diagnosis. Typically, again, the rash is macular or maculopapular. Occasionally, we may see some petechial rashes. But the diagnostic features in identifying these rickettsial infection is SR, that is erythematous rash with a border rim. And in the middle, we have a black dotted skin lesions, by which we'll be able to make a diagnosis of rickettsial infection. But remember, we need to keep our mind open to make a diagnosis of this. Otherwise, we may miss, maybe we may diagnose, but in the late stages of that one, that may end up with a problem. So we need to keep our mind vision. Whenever child comes with the fever and rash, specifically these maculopapular rashes in the palms and soles, we have to consider the possibility of the rickettsial infection. So these are the, some of the skin lesions what we are seeing in the rickettsial infection, like the SR, what is being seen in the right side. Now moving on to the non-infective causes, most importantly drug eruptions. The one form of presentation of drug eruption is maculopapular drug rash. These are diffuse and symmetrical eruption with sometimes associated with the papule malformation. But what is striking here is to make a diagnosis of drug eruption. Generally, these eruptions occur after 7 to 10 days of taking medication. Not immediately, you don't get. Unlike in viral infections, we get rashes in the prodromal phase. This is one of the important features that we get rash only in the after 7 to 10 days. And a common drugs, we can say that almost all drugs can produce drug eruption. Specifically, antibiotics, anticonvulsants, and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are the known causes of drug eruption. So this is a slide differentiating between the viral infection and the drug eruption. As I said, generally, drug eruption takes 7 to 10 days, whereas in viral infection, it will take within, say, 3 to 5 days. During the prodromal phase, you will see the rash. And more importantly, in the drug eruption, a rash appears first over the trunk and then spreads across the extremities. Whereas in viral infection, it starts from the cephalochoidal direction. And fever usually high grade in viral fever, whereas it is low grade in case of drug eruptions. And more important, as I said, there are some exceptions. Usually the skin lesions are pruritic in drug eruption, whereas they are not so pruritic in case of viral infection. Specifically, I mentioned some of them, like chikungunya, we may get itchy skin lesions. Though we are saying these are the differences, but still at time it is difficult to differentiate drug eruption and the viral infection. But we will try and make using these features to differentiate between the drug reaction and the viral infections. The second form of drug eruption is acute generalized eczematous pustulosis. Usually it is acute in onset, but generally it is seen more in adults than in pediatric age group. So usual drug history will be there, and the rashes will appear after 5 to 7 days. And again, it will disappear after taking out the pretended drug. The most dreaded and most drug reaction, what we are seeing in pediatric age group is DRESS syndrome, that is drug rash with eosinophilia and systemic symptoms. It's a variant of, articulated papular exanthema. It mimics like other viral infection and erythema multiforme like regions will be there. But what is characteristic is appearance of facial edema, and in the smear you get eosinophilia. So these are the two typical features by which we will be able to make a diagnosis of DRESS. We stress on this one because the mortality is high with this condition. That's why we need to diagnose this disease earliest. So you may have a skin lesion typical with eosinophilia in the peripheral smear, and you may sometimes have the other clinical features in the form of lymphadenopathy and other organomegaly. So the only thing is we have to make early diagnosis in this so that the outcome will be better. The last one is been seen by all of us in many cases. This is the dreaded form of drug reaction, both like Steven Johnson and toxic epidermal necrolysis. Typically, we have those target lesions. And then the differentiation between always a question mark for all of us. But as per dermatologist, they're saying if there is an epidermolysis involving skin area less than 10%, you can consider SJS. And if it is more than 30%, you can consider 10. In between 10 and 30% will be a mixture of these. So again, common drugs, anticonvulsants, we need to take out that drug, and then the outcome will be at the earliest, so that the outcome will be far, far better. So these are the some of the skin lesions seen in SJS and 10. And similar to that one is serum sickness. Like very way of diagnosis is the erythema on the sides of fingers will be there, and which will be progressing and forming like a urticarial rash. Again, commonly it is due to antibiotics. If you take out the antibiotics, the child will recover with the skin rash. The second form of non-infective causes is what we come across is the connective tissue disorders. These are some of these, like SLE and juvenile dermatomyositis. So SLE, we all know that typical skin lesions, and we have a criteria to make a diagnosis. Out of 11, 4 we can use. And in juvenile dermatomyositis, which is very common than the SLE in pediatric age group, by looking at the heliotrope rash and the Gautran papules, which are there over the metacarpus, we can make a diagnosis. So this is a picture of a rheumatic fever where showing erythema marginatum. So this is the keratic rash of rheumatic fever. And another rash, evanescent rash seen in Still's disease. So these are common diseases like dermatomyositis. You can see heliotrope rash and Gautran's papules. Some of the pictures of, again, dermatomyositis. Look at the bone. The calcinosis is another feature in the long run. That is what is being seen in dermatomyositis. And this is typical pictures of SLE, malar rash. We all very well person with this, this thing. The other important aspect is vasculitis. These are four important conditions which we come across, especially Henoch's Conlan purpura. What is more important for us is non-blanchable purpura, what we are seeing in these, specifically in HS purpura, fever and a rash. Rash appears more so on the buttocks and the lower part of the body. Then it will make a sense that there is a diagnosis possibility. Though we are seeing four characters like arthritis, intussusception, melena, all that are there, but these two are very important to identify the disease at the earliest. Similar to that, there are others like leukocytoclastic vasculitis and polyarthritis nodosa. We have a typical skin lesions by which we will be able to make a diagnosis. Because of time limit, I am just quickly saying that another non-infective cause is Kawasaki disease, and especially we are seeing now with the pandemic going on, we have another entity called incomplete Kawasaki disease, which is typical of the PIMS, or what we call it as multisystem inflammatory syndrome. So Kawasaki diagnosis, again, fever with any of the four skin lesions, what we are seeing. So conjunctival congestion, red fissure lipase, peri-inguinal descamation, polymorphous rash, and cervical lymph node, out of which any four lesion along with the fever, we can make a diagnosis. But what is more important is Kawasaki disease is very common in less than 5 years of age, whereas other non-infective causes are more so in the age group, older age group, more than 5 years or more than specifically 7 years old. So this is how we can describe infective and non-infective. A brief about how we need to approach whenever we get a child with fever and rash. So again, I stress on the fact that we need to take a proper history. age of the child is very important for us. As I told, less than 3 years, very commonly viral infections. More than 7 years, we can get more commonly the non-infective causes rather than the infective causes. And season is also very important because we can get enterovirus during the summer seasons. And in the spring, it is measles very common. And also in the summer season, what we have said, upcoming disease, that is scrub typhus or other rickettsial infection. So taking into that, we have to describe the rash very well. That is when it has started, what is the duration, how it is evaluating, and what is the temporal relation with the fever. All these points you need to take in detail so that we will be able to make a diagnosis properly. More importantly, we need to stress on the point that what is the is there any recent intake of medicine? Because we need to rule out a drug reaction. Sometimes it mimics viral infection, but we have to take that history. And also exposure to allergen is also most important nowadays, as we are seeing more of allergic rashes nowadays. So we have to keep this history in intact and ask properly so that we'll be able to make a diagnosis properly. Along with that, history is the exposure in the family is also most important to consider the incubation period. And more importantly, as an undergraduate, what we have learned is with relation to fever, how and which day the rash has appeared so that we can make a diagnosis faster. So the mnemonic, what we are remembering as an undergraduate is very sick patients must take double tablets. So it indicates day one, varicella, scarlet fever, smallpox. And then the last one is typhoid on the seventh day. So this is typically what we are remembering. And this has been already, I have discussed how we can make a diagnosis based on the progression of the rash. And more importantly, other points we need to make when we are approaching properly, that is there any associated other problems like the associated organomegaly, associated hemorrhagic lesions, or whether child has come in shock. Based on that, we can make a different diagnosis. So again, this is the picture based on typical rashes, we can make a diagnosis. So I have already described this one. So we will supply this one to all pediatricians through our this thing. So you can go through this one easily in your OPD practice and make a diagnosis properly. So again, I have described about this one based on earlier clinical features, the differential diagnosis. Now a word about the algorithm, more for the residents, but in the practicing pediatricians, it may to some extent help this way of approach. So here, once we see a child with a rash, you just need to ask first whether it is a vesicle or something. If it is vesicle, then we have to look at those conditions. If it is not vesicle, is it macular? Then we have to consider all those conditions. If it is not macular, then we need to consider, is it red and scaly? Then we need to consider all these skin disorders. So a brief word about the minimal investigations which will help in diagnosis of fever with rash. Like specifically, as I said, to diagnose infectious mononucleosis, we can have Downy cells. So we can see the peripheral smears, and some of the collagen vascular diseases can come with the renal involvement. So in that way, renal function test will help us in making that. A word about skin biopsy, specifically it will be of very help in cases of identifying the vasculitis and other conditions. So in conclusion, as I said, exanthematous fevers in children have an exhaustive list of causes. It may take days to discuss about fever and rash. But what I wanted to stress here is a stepwise approach consisting of proper history taking, identifying the rash, where it appeared, how it has progressed. That will give us a clinical cue for early diagnosis of the disease with a minimal appropriate investigation. We can conclude and we can make a early diagnosis so that we can start the treatment early, and the outcome of these diseases will be much, much better. Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to take questions related to this one. And I really thank again, once again, the Tamil Nadu State Branch, the Chennai branch and the Ramanathapuram branch for taking up this module for your practicing pediatricians. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vinod sir, for your excellent talk on fever with rash, which is the common conditions seen by pediatricians.